All right, good morning, everybody. It's 8:30. It's time to call this morning's meeting to order. The first item is the approval of the agenda, and we have one agenda addition, and that's a request to approve a resolution for Clay County Trail Blazer Snowmobile Club to apply for the 2017 Trail Equipment Grant, and I would like to put that right after we approve the minutes.
Move to approve with the addition.
Second.
Motion and a second. Any further discussion? Not all in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed, the same sign. Motion carried. Citizens to be heard. You two are both here for agenda addition. Okay. All right, we'll move on then to approval of payment bills and vouchers.
Move to approve.
Second.
Further discussion? All in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed, the same. Motion carried. Approval of minutes from January 24th and February 7th.
So moved.
Second.
We have a motion and a second. All in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed, the same sign. Motion carried. We'll move into our agenda addition, and I'll ask at this time that Greg Strauman, did I pronounce your name right? Greg, do you want to come up and have a chair and
just come up.
You can just come up here if you want. All right. You can introduce yourself and who's with you.
Greg Strauman, I'm Vice President of the Clay County Trailblazer Snowmobile Club.
Okay.
And this is Elroy Hagan.
Elroy Hagan, Trail Coordinator for the Clay County Trailblazer Snowmobile Club.
You've been here before. Yes, I remember. Okay. Okay, you have a request for us. You want to just fill us in a little bit on this?
Correct. So there's these RTP grants that are available to various nonprofits and user groups, motorized trail, non-motorized trail, and a combination thereof. And so we would like to apply for the equipment grant for the motorized trail for our snowmobile trails to purchase the newer groomer unit. Our unit we have is getting older. It's getting to that point where we have a lot of hours on it, and we want to be able to upgrade that. It's a $150,000 grant available, and but it's a 50% match, so it's essentially a $75,000 grant. And so we wanted to apply for that. You know, Norman County got one, Becker County's got the grant before, so we thought we wanted to apply. It was a good time for us to do this. So.
Okay.
And so in the manual here, it says, you know, all user groups may apply, but only in coordination with a local unit of government for legislation. So.
Okay. Mm-hmm.
That's the very short version. So.
Sure. All right. Any questions from the board? Brian, any questions?
No, Mr. Chair. We've been the government sponsor for this group for many years, ever since I've been here and long before that. Elroy comes in with the approval of the to confirm the expenses paid. And the only possible issue is that it's a 50-50 match, and the club has always matched that themselves. They're not asking for county funds to match that, but just wanted to be clear on that point. So,
is that what a new groomer costs, $150,000? Is that cover one, or?
No, they're about $200,000, depending
on what you get, so. Yeah, that cost share issue is addressed right in the resolution.
So. Okay.
I'll move to approve.
I'll second.
We have a motion and a second. Any further discussion? All in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed, the same. Motion carried. All right. You got it? The
trails are a little rough right now.
Do you have an original one that you want signed before you leave here today?
Yes, we do.
Okay. Do they want to take it with them, or?
You want to take that with you? Because Mr. Chair, sorry. The reason why we add it to the agenda, this is time sensitive. They need to get it in February, I think you said it was. So
we should sign it today if we can.
Yes.
Yeah. Got it? Talk to you guys.
Sure, we can sign it right now and you can take it with you.
Perfect, thank you.
Do you have the original? You'll be good to go.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Good luck.
Thanks.
All right, Dave. You have a few action items for us this morning, and then we're gonna get an update from you.
We do have a bid opening around 9:15, so.
Okay, all right.
And the computer holds on for a few more minutes, he's asleep. Thank you.
Come on in.
Thank you.
Your first item, Dave, is the approval of the annual township maintenance contract numbers for 2017, 2018.
Yeah, Ann worked real hard in the last 6 weeks or so and put all these numbers together for us. They came together right just in the nick of time. We did sit down last Tuesday with Highway Committee. We went through the numbers, and Ann was there to help walk us through it. And then on Thursday, Eric met with the townships himself and explained everything, and showed them the good news that the numbers are going down again for this year, another $25 per mile on their annual contract with us. So we did pretty much the exact same process as we've done in the past. We took a look at actual costs for any time spent maintaining township roads, which would be blading gravel and plowing snow. There's no other additional maintenance we do. That's the way our contract reads. There was, in 2016, about 329 hours less motor grader, like summer blading. And as a direct result, there was about 411 more hours snow plowing. So there was more winter than there was summer, so to speak. So the actual cost themselves went up a little bit between 15 and 16 for actual cost. But when you use the five-year rolling average, being that we still have a couple of tough years from 2012, 13, and 14, the five-year average itself went down a little bit. So the cost went up on an annual basis, but five-year average, it did go, still go down. So last year, or the current year, that our year runs, just for Commissioner Haney's, our year runs from July 1st through June 30th. So we're still finishing up the 2016-17 contract, which is at $7.96 per mile. And the proposed contract that I'd like to get approved today is at $7.70 per mile. So it's down about $26 or so.
And Dave, we did make that change on the
Yeah, we did one thing to explain
inflationary,
to you is,
the inflationary number.
Yep.
They worked that in.
Correct. When we actually start spending time on their roads, it would be in, you know, we actually start beginning of the year, so January 1st or so of any given year we start spending. We don't actually collect on that till the previous July. So for 18 months or so, we're kind of cash flowing these expenditures, and then we don't get reimbursed, you know, because we take a look in the rearview mirror before we put the contract together. So in the meantime, we've got steps, we've got raises, we've got inflation on everything else. So in order to cover our own costs a little bit, we did throw an inflationary factor into our numbers, and it was at 1.5%, and we just bumped it up to 2% for this current contract. It didn't change it a lot. I think it was $3.77, roughly $4 per mile it raised it up. But yet it kind of helps, I think, keep the county whole a little bit. So.
It raised it compared to what it was at 1.5.
Correct.
But it's still, even though that raised it, it's still lower than.
Yep,
than
still down $26 per mile.
Okay, so we need to have that, the approval of that, so he can forward that then to the townships, right, for their annual
meeting?
Correct,
yeah.
Move to approve that.
Second.
Contract at 770 mile.
Okay, we have a motion and a second. Any further discussion? All in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye. Aye.
Opposed, the same. Motion carried. Okay. Next, we have the revised memorandum of understanding with the city of Glendon for Park Avenue reconstruction project.
Yeah, this was previously approved in October of 2015. We've since done some additional work with the city and made a couple of real small changes on the MOU. I think Eric maybe forwarded that to you and got some yellow highlights on there. Their attorney went through it as well as Jenny from our county highway department. Maybe I'll just have Eric kind of walk through that real briefly.
Yeah, so I guess just rewind, give a really brief background. As you all know, we will be doing the urban reconstruction of Linden in 2018, and it'll be a cooperative project with the city and the county. So essentially this agreement just spells out exactly what will happen during the construction process. You know, we'll both be owners, we'll both approve all the numbers. And as far as the agreement, as Dave said, it was approved in 2015, but we did make some really minor changes. Probably the biggest one being, if we do need to buy land for a stormwater pond, which is a possibility, it'd be a 50-50 split for the land with the city.
I think the current MOU kind of spells out that, you know, if it's on a county roadway and we're doing a cooperative project, normally the county would acquire the right-of-ways, and that would be kind of, you know, we may share on that, but it would kind of be county right-of-way if it's a strip adjacent to a road. But on something like a city project, we may purchase a pond somewhere off the roadway, which would more than likely happen. And in that case, that we didn't think the language applied, it was kind of a special case. So we adjusted it to handle storm pond.
So we didn't necessarily change anything, we just clarified a few things, is basically the majority of it. And I think most of it was highlighted in the agreement. So, and then probably the most important thing for everyone to understand is the table on page 3, which actually explains the cost splits with the city and the county for the construction costs and the design and construction engineering, so.
Yeah, storm sewer is a 50-50 split. All the roadway reconstruction is more of a 70-30 split between 70 county, 30 city. And then anything underground, sanitary sewer and water main is all 100% city. So it's pretty similar to the ones we've done in the past. We did one with Moorhead right outside the courthouse here a few years ago, and that ended up being a 60-40 split. There was a little bit wider parking, you know, there's more parking lanes there. With the one we did down with Glendon, I think, do you remember what the one was in Barnesville, I mean?
There was different segments, but some of them were 50-50 in different pieces.
Yeah.
So real similar to what we've done in the past, I guess. And we've been working directly with the city of Glendon kind of through this whole process, updating it, so.
Okay. So they're requesting the approval of the revised MOU.
I'll move to approve.
Motion to approve. For a second?
Second.
Any questions, any more questions on the MOU? All in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed, the same. Motion carried. All right, Dave, the next we have the design engineering contract for the reconstruction of CASA 19 in Glendon.
Yeah, this is a design contract with Alltag Engineers, who is the current city engineer for the city of Glendon, to do the design for this project, which we just approved the MOU on. We were looking at trying to do some of this work in-house, and we have done all the survey and provided that to them at a little bit of a savings to the city and the county. But I would like to get approval for a design contract. I think with all the different parameters going on here, there's a lot of stormwater that runs through this street that we were going to hire out as well. But I think it would probably make sense to have the city kind of handle the engineering part of this. There is also a little bit of a price tag that comes with it. We negotiated this thing down to 8% of construction costs that would be split according to that table Eric explained on the different items. But an 8% cost on the numbers that we have, preliminary numbers we have to date, would be about $150,000 for the county's portion. I talked to Lori a little bit, as I don't have that money earmarked in 2017 in my consulting budget, but she said that we took a look back at our fund reserves, and she did give me the go-ahead based on your guys' approval to use some fund reserves from previous years. Like in 2016, we had a lot of right-of-way dollars set aside for County Road 95 that we didn't need any right-of-way, so I had $162,000 of right-of-way from last year that we didn't use, as well as there was some fuel money, and I think it was to the tune of over $760,000 of additional funds from 16. But our fund balance is sitting really good right now, and I took a look at it and proposed maybe using some of the reserves for this design contract, and it did meet her approval, I guess. And we kind of talked about it a little bit at Highway Committee as well.
Okay. I'll move to approve.
Okay, we have a motion to approve the CASA 19 contract. Second, anybody?
Second.
Second, all right. Further discussion? All in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed, the same. Motion carried. All right, our next item is the resolution to advance the SA account.
This is our annual resolution that we bring forward. Once you advance dollars from your state aid account, as soon as the previous allotment comes, you pay back that advance, and then you need, you know, if you need to expend state aid dollars, you need to advance from the previous years. It's kind of a revolving cycle. What this resolution does here is it kind of clarifies our current balance, the projects that we have proposed for 2017, and then, which also includes our 2017 bond payment, which is set for $2,235,000. So that takes two-thirds of our $3.2 million allotment. We've got a few projects in there that we've kind of earmarked on our five-year road plan. And then the maximum amount that we can advance from 2018's allotment is $966,260, which we need in order to construct the projects on our current five-year plan. So we'd like to get approval on this, and we get it to the state right
so,
away.
So you're requesting the resolution to advance the 966?
Yeah.
What was that number?
It's 966,260, which is our, you know, you don't really know what your 2018 allotment is at this time, so it's your 2017 allotment minus our bond payment. Is that right?
Yep.
So in our bond payments, the $2.235 million.
So do you need separate action then, because you're also saying that you need to advance $36,000 from your regular construction account? What's
no, I believe that is, we need this part of that 966 will pay back the $36,000.
Oh.
So it's all kind of rolled in there.
Okay.
I think we initially started going down that road, but the state kind of clarified up how we should put this resolution together.
And do you have a resolution made up?
Yep. I wonder if on my copy here, I wonder if that's incorrect. Is that an old copy?
Yep. So I did send out a new copy on Friday. I don't know if you guys got this long list of.
Yeah, I didn't get that stuff.
No, we just got the.
Is that this one?
Yeah.
No.
No.
That was the consent agenda.
Just got a long list of all our projects. $966,260.
Colleen's going to make some copies.
That's fine, Colleen.
We'll just pass it around.
We can just look at it real quick. You don't need to do that.
You guys can pass it around.
Mr. Chair, I'll make a motion to approve the the advance of the SA account in the amount of $966,260.
Second. We have a second. Any further discussion? All in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye. Aye.
Opposed, same. Motion carried. All right. So you want to do your road and bridge update now? Is that
yeah, we could go ahead and get going on that. One thing that I wanted to make note of is the bid opening at 9:15, so those electronic, anyone that may have put an electronic bid together, we can't get those numbers until right at 9 o'clock. So we, like if you remember from last year, we kind of had that little hiccup at the beginning. So we had a couple guys in the IT room that are going to get those numbers, so we won't really have anything ready till about 9:15 or so, but my update may take a long anyway.
All right. Well, let's get into your update.
All right. As I was putting this together, I realized that it may not be so much more of an update on an annual basis, but maybe a little more information just on the highway department itself. So if there's anything specific in this last 6 to 9 months or future 6 to 9 months you want me to explain, we'll go ahead and ask me those questions. our highway department is pretty much made up of three main areas. We've got maintenance, we've got engineering, we've got administration. On the maintenance side, we've got motor grader operators, we've got truck drivers or snowplow operators, we've got a guy in the sign department putting up all the signs that get knocked down or putting up new ones, and then we've got two guys in our shop department that keep all of our fleet running. On the engineering side of the highway department, we've got five engineering technicians. They're all MnDOT certified. They go to trainings every year for new things, as well as they have to do refreshers. MnDOT has a really good certification program, and our guys are all certified in the different areas between gravel, grading, hot mix, concrete, testing, many different areas. I've also got our assistant engineer kind of in that engineering area. And then administration, we've got two office staff that kind of take care of all the permitting, all the calls and all the organizing of all the vouchers, as well as I got myself in there. And then we do have a dedicated highway accountant that works out of the courthouse here. She's absolutely wonderful. She takes care of a lot of things, and anything that that we do gets scrutinized by the state auditors, so she has to make sure all of our things are in order, we don't miss anything. Every so often, we do stray down the wrong road a little bit, and Ann brings us right back where we belong. So it really helps with our annual audits. Our bookwork always seems like it's right in order the way they want it. So, just a little brief snapshot there of our organizational chart. I worked with Darren on this a while back, and I never really did quite complete it the way I wanted it. So hopefully in the near future, I'll kind of readjust that a little bit. It seemed like our, and this has been this way since before I started, but it's real long and flat. There's really no branches the way I think it should be. So everyone's kind of a little bit on the same plane, which doesn't make it maybe quite as efficient as it could be. So, but for the most part, there's the county engineer and the assistant engineer. And then from there, you've got some different section managers. You got your sign foreman on the right. That doesn't really have anybody full-time underneath him. The shop foreman's got a diesel mechanic that works under him. The maintenance foreman's got the bulk of all the staff there. He's got the 11 motor grader operators and the 6 full-time truck drivers, as well as all the part-time staff that works in the summer and winter. We got the engineering technicians, and then we got the office staff. So I've got different examples from different counties, and I was going to try to tweak things a little bit, but never quite got it all figured the way I wanted it. In order to perform maintenance in Clay County, like I said, we got 11 maintenance districts. All of our roads are broken up into those 11 districts, with each motor grader district having about 125 miles. We do have 8 outlying shops. Most of them are one-man posts, but the Barnesville shop houses 4 guys, and then the new shop in Holly will have 2 full-time guys as well as their part-timers. So, and then our department headquarters is right in Moorhead. I took a picture of one of our motor graders there. We purchased those a couple years ago. We got 6 brand new John Deere's and 2 brand new Caterpillars. Price tag on those things at that time was about $290,000. That's one of the, probably the best picture of one of our snowplow trucks. Almost all of our trucks now are the same brand and the same style, which makes a good thing for repairs and for buying parts. And we've been just having really good luck with the Freightliner brand. And I think we got one coming here in the next couple of weeks. So looking forward to get that. So I've got pictures of all these outlying shops for any of you that may or may not have seen them. It's funny how they almost look all identical, and we'll kind of run through them here. Up in the northwest part of the county, we've got Georgetown. That's a one-man post, and all that fits in there is the motor grader. Years ago, maybe they could get a blade and a truck in there, but at this time, it's just the motor grader and maybe a pickup truck. There's the Felton shop. That one is a little bit bigger. He can get a truck and a motor grader as well as a pickup truck in that one. It's probably one of our top three, outlying shops right there. There's the Ulan shop. That one there is starting to have issues with the foundation. I think I mentioned this at Highway Committee a little bit. If you stand there and look at the windows on the north side of the building, they're kind of tweaked a little bit. The whole building starting to settle, and we've had to do some grinding on the concrete to get the door to shut properly. And I think it's not too far away from possibly looking at a real small one-man post, but the building's not doing real good. There's the Rolog shop that we currently have for sale. There's a title issue with the land to the south there, and we're working with Clay County Abstract on that. I checked on it a couple weeks ago, and I'm trying to speed them along a little bit. The owner that put the bid in on it still is excited about the bid that he put in, and he's, I said, the additional time's helping him out a little bit, getting some of his numbers together. We have gotten rid of the dumpsters, so we're not paying a garbage service on that. The heat's turned down. We weren't able to turn the heat off because it does have the alarm on the water and that sort of thing. So we kind of have it heated really lightly right now, but hoping to get rid of that one here within the next month or so. There's our Comstock shop. They're down in the southeast or southwest part of the county. There again, that one's a real small shop. It's not able to have the truck and the blade in there. So these ones that can handle the truck in there, like Georgetown and Comstock, that truck comes all the way from Moorhead. As it drives down there. So it has a little bit of some of that deadheading issues that we had talked about with the new landfill. I mean, some of these shops have a little bit of deadheading as well, but the trucks actually, they make up pretty good ground. They can drive regular speeds. So There's a Glendon shop. That's probably another one of our, that's maybe our number two shop other than our brand new ones. You can see it's a little bit more modern look in there. It's got some good, they recently put some insulation there not too long ago, and there's quite a bit more room in this one here. There's our Barnesville shop that we built in, I think it was 2011. Real nice shop there. It's got all the different doors on there. It's quite a bit different style of the shop that we built at the landfill, but it just worked out that way. We didn't need more of a drive-in, drive-out kind of a shop. This one here, each unit has its own bay, and absolutely works out fantastic since we put this one together. So had very little, if any, issues since we built this one. There's the existing or the old Holly shop that we're recently put up for sale, or we're going to put up for sale. We're still waiting on an MPCA kind of approval on the soil samples that we took, and I don't see any.
This week, actually.
Oh, great. So I guess our plan was, we did get board approval to put this one up for sale. So as soon as we have all the approvals from PCA, we'll get it in the paper and Craigslist, and then we'll get approval of a date here to open bids at the county board meeting. There's a new shop that we recently moved in the last couple of weeks. The way I was looking at the picture the other day, I thought, well, maybe I should just kind of draw a line. You can kind of see the two big doors to the right, those are set aside for landfill equipment. They haul leachate and ash and garbage to Perham, so they actually like need their stuff inside. So you can actually drive a semi-truck in side by side in the big doors, and you can put equipment in the other doors. So it's going to work out really good for them, being able to drive in and drive out. Then the door to the left, the big door, that's kind of a drive-in, drive-out on our side, which is highway side, and then you can then branch out either to the left or right with your trucks and your motor grader. So I think I've got a picture. You can kind of see on the left there, that's our side there where you can park on left or the right, and it's certainly going to meet our needs for many years. Guys were really looking forward to it. It turned out really nice. We did put some nice bright LED lights in there. You can kind of see the lighting is fantastic, and there's a lot of room in there, and so far it's going to work out real good. And then on the right there, in our bids, we just spec certain items. You know, we need lockers, we need this, need that. And the Foltz company that built this building, they actually found these lockers on sale and put them in there. And geez, they're sure nice. They look fantastic. A lot of the equipment that he puts in there, he puts quality equipment in there. The table and chairs in the break room are all super heavy and really nice equipment, and no complaints on the. Even the garage door openers he put in there, really nice, heavy-duty garage door openers that aren't going to fall apart and cost us money in the future. So. There's our main shop in Moorhead. As I note there, this is a shared facility with the city and the state. We moved in this building July of 2002, and they're going to have had absolutely no issues intergovernmentally, I guess, with the other entities. We share on all the costs there, and I think it's just absolutely a great deal for the county. There is our cold storage tent, I guess. The city of Moorhead, when we moved in there, they didn't have funds or need, I guess, to join in on this venture. So this one is, I think it's two-thirds county, one-third MnDOT. It is a certain brand of building that's went out of business. And at one point, shortly after they went out of business, they were going to tear all these down because there was some structural issues in certain parts of the country on these. But our buildings, our tents were inspected and allowed to remain, but yet there is kind of a short window on them. And I believe at one time they told me it was a 2018 replacement. MnDOT's kicked that back now to 2021, which I'm kind of glad, because that's going to cost us our share as well. And they seem to be holding up just fine. But like I said, there was some structural issues. MnDOT looked into it, hired a structural firm to go in there and take a look at it, and gave them a little bit more life. And I believe the tarping system is only good for about 20 years. So we'll be real close to that 20 years by the time they tear them down. But it's kind of a shame. We got to tear the whole thing down. But
Dave, how did we fund that originally?
I'm trying to think of where the funds on that came. The thing cost a couple $100,000. And I don't know. I bet it came from them capital reserves or the bond funds that we had for capital improvements, if I remember right. I think that's kind of.
I don't know that I've seen that on our schedule. The capital improvement area.
No, it hasn't been.
I think we need to look at that. And I don't recall it ever being part of money coming out of our 5-year stuff.
No,
it had nothing to do with that.
No, Like I said, I think when they rolled the bond for our share of the building, I think these tents were kind of somewhat earmarked in there as well, if I remember right.
Okay, they were in the original finance.
I believe so, yep, many, many years ago. The other tent that's side by side here is our salt sand tent. This one also is slated to be replacement in 2021. And as you can kind of see, we got salt on the right. We've got salt sand, which is kind of, you know, for the most part, MnDOT doesn't use any sand. They use almost all pure salt on their roads. They've got a bare pavement policy. It requires a lot of salt in order to burn that off. The bigger pile, the sand pile, kind of in the middle there, that's Clay County's pile. That's 10% salt, 90% sand, which is what we typically use. If the conditions warrant it, we will add additional salt to the individual load, kind of to heat it up, so to speak. And then the littlest pile on the left, that's the city of Moorhead's little sand pile. And most of that is recycled sand still from their sandbagging operation that when we tore them sandbags apart, there is debris and things in there that the state and the county weren't really interested in having that run through our sanding conveyors and things. So, but the city's made it work, and that's kind of how it all works. We all have our own piles and keep track of it.
Do we mix up that salt sand
yep.
mix?
Yep, when we need to, our guys go out there and mix up a little pile, and then they withdraw it from our inventory because we have it all tracked on each individual salt, and then the mixed sand, so all the numbers have to jive at the end of the year.
We have other places that we store sand.
Yep, we've got in Holly, we share a facility with MnDOT there, and then same in Barnesville too. So pretty much are in the same situation in Holly, Barnesville, and Moorhead. MnDOT facilities.
And does the city use some up their highway or up their?
I think the city of Holly buys.
No, I'm talking about the city of Moorhead on 15th Avenue here. Do they?
Yep, I believe that's where their main location is for their sand and salt, and they are really a minor player in this situation here. Yeah. Okay. All right. Here's our project that our maintenance guys did by the County 12 Bridge there. The homes at Crestwood got removed and the guys were down there fishing and we didn't know how to keep them out of there. So our guys went in and built a little gravel parking lot so that they wouldn't have to drive down there and then put up all the rocks there. Rather than a fence, we talked about maybe some sort of a fence system, and our maintenance foreman, Brian Friedrich, kind of came up with that idea, I think, and guys, it actually worked out real good. You don't have to worry about ever putting future dollars in there now, like or someone getting hurt out there running a snowmobile into a barbed wire fence or something.
The only thing I'd say is I think we talked about that gate that is there.
Yep.
And it is not locked. So
okay.
A lot of people last fall were just opening and driving down and fishing. So I think the gate initially detracts certain people, but it's not locked.
Okay. All right. Well, I thought maybe with the current weather, it wouldn't hurt to show a few pictures of some old floods there. That's the North Broadway Bridge there. As you can see, it's a really low-lying structure, and it gets a tremendous amount of debris on top of it, and it's a real pain to clean up when it gets said and done there. So the first picture I had, this one here, is looking southbound across the bridge into the city of Fargo. This is actually the road looking northbound that's recently been fully replaced with the new dike system on that the watershed built. So this roadway here doesn't exist anymore. It's actually been shifted to the east about 200 feet or so.
That's
and
County
completely
one.
Rebuilt. Yeah, this is County Road 1 here, or North Broadway, and it's all brand new and been recently rebuilt. And as you can see, this one took a pretty good hitting there in 2009. This is our County Road 26, just north of where County Road 95 intersects it, north of the Amber Wave subdivision out there. And all the overlanding water from the Buffalo River comes straight across at about a 45 degree angle, and it hits this low point and it completely took our road out. There again, I think that was in 09 as well. Picture on the left is up by Georgetown, County Road 36 as it goes across. You can see how one Clay County resident gets in and out of his home there. Not very ideal. And then on the right there, I think is it's County Road 108. It's kind of northeast of Cragness a little bit. As you can see, it's just when the water comes in Clay County, whether we have a diversion or not, we're still going to see some of this stuff here because it's coming out of the Buffalo and it's coming out of the other tributaries in Clay County. But we're so flat as everything comes down from the Holly area, from the glacial Lake Agassiz, that it just spreads out and it does a lot of damage, but this is kind of what it looks like. It wipes off all the gravel, it'll chew out where the culverts are, and then we come back in and put clay and gravel back in and replace culverts where we need it. And we've been doing it probably that way for 100 years or so. But. All right, I'll get into our roadway system a little bit. The highway department, or most counties have, as you all know, there's different jurisdictions in that. We've got state aid highways, and we've got county roadways, and then we also do maintenance on the township roads. So as far as the state aid highways, they're entirely funded by the gas taxes, the tab fees, and I also forgot about the motor vehicle sales tax, which give our, and I'll talk about that a little more later. We've got 404 miles of state aid highways, which are typically your more heavily traveled roadways, but not always. We've got a lot of lower volume gravel roadways that are also on the state aid system. Of our 404, 272 are either paved with asphalt or concrete, and 132 miles are gravel. So you can see there's more paved than gravel roads on the state aid system. Now on the next slide, you can see on the county system, which are funded almost exclusively by our local levy dollars, 339 miles of county roads, but we've got 322 that are gravel and 17 that are paved, which is good. You don't want a lot of paved roads on your county system. We draw better needs from our allotment based on those paved roads if they're on the state aid system. So since I took over in 05, I've transferred about a dozen miles from this county system to the state aid system that are on the that are paved. I guess it just it gives us a little better share of the gas tax dollars. So we've also got a lot of bridges that we have to take care of. There's 335 bridges and culverts that are over 10 feet wide in Clay County. This does include the township system as well. And something that we've never really talked about, but all the work that we do for the townships, we also perform all the bridge inspections, whether they're annually or semi-annually or every 4 years. But we our bridge inspector does all this work, and we track it, and I sign off on it. We do all this at no cost to the townships. It's something that we've always done. And then there, as far as the maintenance, last year and this current year hasn't changed, but there's 745 miles that we maintain for the township. So we do an awful lot of work for them. They're a good partner, and we appreciate the cooperation that we do, and that it funds a great portion of our maintenance and our equipment and our staff and everything else. So road and bridge annual budget, I just took a real quick snapshot there, and this varies depending on what you got going on. I think in 2015 we probably had a lot of construction that kicked that up a little bit, but we're somewhere in, and I thought it was like around 10 million, but it's actually 12 and pushing $13 million of our annual budget. Our average levy for the highway department is between $2.5 and $3.5 million. So everything else is usually funded from the state. Here's our state aid allotment there. As you can see, when I started in 01, our annual allotment, you know, this is just construction. It's not the maintenance that we get from the gas taxes, but just the construction was just a hair over 2 million. It stayed real flat that way for about 8-9 years. We hardly gained any ground at all. And then in 2010, I believe, is roughly when that motor vehicle sales tax took in effect. And I'm not, you know, everybody was excited when that happened. And I think a lot of the rural counties kind of conceded a little bit, because there was a different funding formula for the motor vehicle sales tax, new money, for the new money. It's more of a 60-40 split based on registrations and mile and needs, whereas the first money, the old money, is set up 10% by equalization. There's 30%, I think, by lane miles, and there's 50% by money needs. And anyway, it's was set up more complicated but more fair for everyone. The new money was maybe set up a little bit better for counties that have a lot of registrations and a lot of big money needs, such as interchanges and things like that. But nonetheless, it, as you can see, our money has grown quite a bit. So the first 9 years I was here, we raised $200,000 additional allotment. The last 7 years, we've raised over a million. So it's nice to see that continue to grow. We really need those dollars.
Yeah, when that new formula thing came through, there was I served on as one of 17 commissioners that was on that negotiating.
Sure.
And there was no way that we would have ever seen any new money without having the new formula and the new money.
I remember that. And it was all or nothing.
And I know that the metro area does get a bigger share of the new money formula versus the old formula. But then when you look and see where the money was coming from, they made the case that, you know,
that's where it was coming from.
That's where the money is coming from, yeah. So they should get that. So, but what we did see in this is that we knew all counties would at least start seeing some improved revenues, and you can certainly see it based on the chart, so.
Yeah, for sure. And then just to kind of wrap it up, some of our upcoming projects, we're going to open bids actually shortly on a Hagan Township Bridge replacement. We've got a bridge on County Road 57 that's been sitting on the shelf for about a year now, waiting for bridge bond funds, so hopefully there's a bonding bill passed this spring. We're going to pave County Road 6 south of Rolog, that's all ready to go. Probably open bids on that one sometime in the next maybe 5 or 6 weeks, I would guess. We have to advertise for a month, so that usually takes up that time. We are going to work with MnDOT on a signal replacement on the City of Holly. MnDOT's doing a big project on Trunk Highway 10, they're doing some access management, and they have graciously gotten $200,000 from Clay County for that signal. 12th Avenue Reconstruct, that's by Horizon School there, we're also working with City of Moorhead on that one. We're cost sharing that one to the tune of about $500,000, and then we're also doing a turnback, or we've done a turnback, so we'll turn that all back to City of Moorhead, so. It's going to be a real nice project. I think there, it looks like things are coming along pretty good with their school out there. As well as, I know Eric and some of our staff will be real busy this summer on the courthouse parking lot projects. Current workload and other hot item issues, I guess. We did just wrap up our township maintenance calculation meetings. Eric and I started working last week on our 5-year road plan, and we plan to bring that to the highway committee next month, and then to the county board shortly thereafter. We're working with the City of Glendon and Alltag Engineering on our 2018 project. We've got federal aid funds for the Heartland Trail portion, or a 10-foot wide path on one side of the road. It's going to be an absolutely fabulous project. I'm really looking forward to this one, and I've been telling the city that it might be one of those award-winning projects. So we're going to take a lot of pictures, and hopefully at the end of it, something that we can submit for an urban project award through the state. We're wrapping up the sale on both the Rolog and Holly shop, so we're hoping to get those done. Like I said, Rolog, we're just waiting on that title issue to get run through. And then in Holly, there, we're just waiting for the MPCA letter. We're finalizing our move-in at the landfill. Just like when we moved into Barnesville, there's just a lot of little things that you need to, you know, we had to build benches or some additional tools that we had to buy, some small equipment, and our guys are working really good on that. It's going really good, and I'm glad the weather is what it's been, so it gave us some time to do it. We're working with Holly on a big project in either 2020 or 2021. They've got some water and sewer they need to replace. We've got a rural mill and overlay that we were doing in the same area, and then there's a little piece in between that we're still kind of negotiating, but more than likely there'll be a couple of years worth of road projects being done just on the north side of Holly, and then 6 miles out of town. We're also working with the Diversion Authority on some of the roads within the City of Comstock. I got a call from the mayor last week, Mayor Comstock, and he's real concerned about drainage and what we can do. It's on our radar, and I'd like to try to do something in the City of Comstock, and at the Highway Committee we've talked about trying to work on the schedule that works with the Diversion Authority as they come through with the road raises in this area. So we're going to have a meeting with the City of Comstock, I think, in a couple weeks. We're also working at the Heartland Trail. I think Eric's been spending a lot of time on these monthly meetings, trying to find a suitable trail alignment, whether it's from Holly to the State Park or from the State Park into Dilworth. But Frank, I think you're a little involved with that still. Mm-hmm. Seemed like it's really finding a hard time getting traction. Maybe that's the best way to say it. So hopefully the DNR and the Metro Cog and the county and the local jurisdictions can find some ground there to get moving on that a little bit. And we're also working with City of Fargo. That bridge on North Broadway showed all the trees that were over the top of that bridge. It does have an abutment issue on the, would be kind of on the south side of the bridge, I guess. We've known it for a long time, and we've been keeping a good eye on it. But it's starting to catch the attention of MnDOT and the City of Fargo that does the bridge inspections as well. And what we decided to do is put together an RFP for more of an intense inspection and kind of a tracking project on this one. So I'm kind of glad that we're looking at this thing, just, you know, for the safety of anybody going across it. Like I said, we've been surveying this. The abutment's tipping a little bit, which is really well known for our area. The soils in our area are just the worst that they could be. I believe this one doesn't have quite the amount of abutment or piling that it should have. I think it had a single row piling, should have had a double row piling in there. It was built in the mid-80s or so, and Nonetheless, it's got issues out there, but we're doing the right things to keep a good eye on it, and we're working at City of Fargo on that. Last slide I have here is we're gathering information for our yearly supply and gravel bids. That's something that we do in the springtime, so that's in the near future here. The next couple of weeks, we'll be doing that. We're also working on year one of three for the replacement of all the street and avenue signs in Clay County. That was like a four-year, five-year project that we started in 1999. Those signs are only good for so many years, and we're going to make replacement of year one here this coming summer. So we're kind of working on getting the bids on that, figuring out exactly which quadrant. I think you guys pretty much have a game plan on that. Is that right?
Split the county into three sections, and we'll just chip away at it.
So we'll be doing that this summer. And then just last week, we actually worked on a night survey. So we had all the districts in the county, all the two-man blade and truck teams went out at night, and they drove every one of our roads and looked at our signs just to make sure reflectivity wasn't all wore out. And there's two ways you can look at reflectivity. You either do it at night, or you can have a fancy $10,000 gun that you shine on it, and it tells you what the reflectiveness is on it. And we don't have one of those guns, so we went out and did a night survey, and it was really good. It for one sign guy to go out and to drive all the roads and to do all this, it would have taken him weeks, so it was kind of nice. We had the guys together, brought them in, explained what we need, and then we sent them out about 6:30, and they worked from 6 to 10 and got it done. So that's about all I got.
All right, I have a couple questions for you from the MC conference, but I'll hold those. We'll wait till after we do your bid opening.
Okay.
Keep all these other people waiting. So I see your people just walked in with the bids. We can keep going on that.
Does the reflectivity degrade from solar radiation or something?
Oh, yeah.
Okay.
Were received by 9 a.m., correct?
Yep, there'll be a timestamp and I'll read it for you.
Mm-hmm. We've only got one electronic bid, I see, and then it looks like about four paper bids. So we'll read all the paper bids first. We'll do the electronic bid last. This is a bid opening for a bridge replacement on Township Road. It's in Hagen Township, and we worked with this township quite a bit over the last year and a half or so. It's an absolutely beautiful setting. It's on the south branch of the Wild Rice River, kind of northeast of the city of Felton. It's just gorgeous down there. It's not a very heavily traveled roadway, but there's a lot of gravel resources in here. A lot of farm and agricultural, as well as hunting type of traffic. And we asked them if they'd be willing to close the bridge down, and kind of gave that a shot, which is kind of what the state wants you to do if you've got. Clay County is a little unique in the fact we've got a lot of bridges in every mile, north and south, east and west, but there's not always a lot of easy ways around closing bridges. And we've closed probably 10, 12 bridges since I started here 15 years ago. But this was one that they weren't interested in doing that, so we proceeded forward on a design contract with Erickson Engineering. And we got that all done, and now we're to a point where we're going to open bids and see how they turn out. Looks like our engineer's estimate for the bridge work is $594,286. So, see
what
the bids come
out. And you do have an addendum?
No.
No?
No addendum.
No addendum.
Okay. So this. Okay.
And we'll do the electronic one here first before a computer dies on us
okay.
or something. So we did get a bid. One electronic bid. It's from Robert R. Schroeder Construction. The bid was received at 8:23 a.m. It was a complete bid with the electronic bid bond, and the bid amount was $568,426.75. That's $568,426.75. Bid is from Corby Contracting.
I think they're out of Fergus Falls.
Okay. Classic. We do have a bid bond present in the amount of 5%.
Bid for Corby Construction is $508,297.40. $508,297.40.
$508?
Yep. 508,297.40.
There is from Swain Construction. Yeah, do have a bid bond present in the amount of.
Some of those bid bond forms are kind of hard to see it, isn't it?
Equal to 5%.
Oh, there it yep. is. There. So this is Swingin' Construction?
Yep.
I think they're based out of Grand Forks. And the bid from Swingin' Construction is $694,765.00. $694,765.00. I'm not really sure where they're from. This must be the first time I think they've bid.
Black Duck.
Black Duck, okay.
Okay, bid bond is present in the amount of 5%.
Bid from, I think it's Garrett Hansen Contracting, is $540,237.00. $540,237.00.
Present in the amount of 5%.
All right, the bid for Redstone Construction is $569,509.25. $569,509.25.
Present the amount of 5%.
And the bid for structural specialties is $626,601.00. $626,601.00. Well, it looks like some pretty good bids. Some are a little higher and some are a little lower. I guess maybe at this point we could take a contingent approval of Corby Contracting. As a parent low bidder, we'll go through and retabulate everything and make sure everything's in order. And if anything is in order, we'll bring it back the following meeting, or if it's not in order, I should say.
Okay. All right. Do we want to have a motion to accept?
I'll make the motion.
Second.
Okay, we have a motion and a second to accept Corby's with review of the numbers, huh?
Yep, correct.
Any further discussion? All in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed, same. Motion carried. All right. Dave, we've got a couple things for you here. At the AMC Transportation Committee meeting, and maybe for Brian too, some of this, are you aware of a ADA transition plan?
Yep. Clay County put one together about 3 years ago or so.
Okay. And that plan needs to be complete between the years 2019 and 2022. Do you know where we are with that?
Our plan was complete about 3 years ago.
It's all complete?
Yep.
Okay. All right. And does that include the MPO portion from MetroCog?
I guess I'm not sure on what that means, but I know what it is. We hired a consultant to do all inventory in all Clay County property to include the courthouse here. We followed the federal guidelines on it. It was something that was supposed to be done in like about 1986 or something.
Okay. Yeah, it's been extended, but I know there's a lot of counties that haven't even started yet.
Absolutely. And I know the MnDOT's actually, and the feds are threatening to withhold right. monies if you don't have it done, but I think all our ducks should be in order.
Okay, well, that's great. Then a couple of things, the that Ted Schoenecker.
Schoenecker.
Yeah. He gave a little talk, and he said that right now in the bonding there's $70 million for local bridges, and he said there's $36 million already in requests, and that there's an additional $72 million just for two bridges in the metro area.
Budget buster bridge.
Yeah, so when you look at those numbers up there and when they talk about where the dollars go, and one of them happens to be the bridge that that we go over there that's right on Kellogg in St. Paul there, that,
okay.
that big bridge that's right there, apparently that's gonna have to be redone. So
the Wabasha Bridge?
That's the one that goes right over I-94.
Okay.
Right when you come off of Marion and Kellogg, it's okay. that one. It's a huge bridge, anyway. And then also, they were talking that there are no wetland bank credits available for Clay County.
Yep, our bank's been closed, and I think we talked right. about that a little bit a few months back. But
yeah,
so I know that there's money being, and I guess I'm not 100% sure, but I know there's money in the capital bonding bill for Bowser. And I'm hoping that that would eventually get back to a point where we would have okay. availabilities. But I think several of those banks areas are being closed. There's just no funding for it. And you know, we've had Bowser's came to our county engineers screening board meeting last fall, as well as I think they came to another or maybe our board of directors meeting. And yeah, it's a serious issue. If we have any grading projects where right. we need to replace wetlands, we'll no longer have their assistance to do it, which they're spelled out statutorily to take care of wetlands for counties, but they don't have any funds. They've been I think working on about half the amount of funds that they need. I think they figure they need over $13 million a year, and they've been given between $3 and $4 million. So they've been getting kind of going in the hole on this.
Well, the good news on this in terms of lobbying for the funding for that is yep. is they just closed the fourth region. You know where it is?
Down the cities?
The metropolitan.
Yeah.
So once they run out of money, then you know the squeaky wheel, it just, we got a little bit more power sure. there, but just so they don't take it all. But because that mitigation on wetlands can be
yep.
very, very costly.
I've been thinking, you know, there is obviously places that you can go to purchase your own wetland credits if you need to. And I've been meaning on making a few phone calls and say, you know, if we need 5 acres, what's it gonna cost Clay County and kind of getting, you know, just so the guy knows what it is gonna, what the impacts are to our county if we do need to do that. And
yep.
when we do, we don't have a lot of grading in the you know, on our 5 year plan. It's mostly, we're finally to a point in Clay County where we're mostly preserving what we have. Up until now, I think we've been always having at least one grading project here and there, but,
yeah.
and we do still have a couple of roads yet that we could grade. It's so costly. Just like County Road 95, you know, we spent a little over $1 million grading it, and we'll spend another $3 million paving it. So anytime you got to do those, you know, you can't grade it for $1 million and pave it for $1 million like we used to 15 years ago.
But just a reminder, though, for and maybe for Commissioner Haney and I think and even Commissioner Mojo wasn't on the board at the time, but the county road, it's been switched now, was County Road 12
Yep.
Or is that the new highway number for it now, the one that goes past Max out there?
That's 13.
Yeah, okay, 13. It's 13 now. Well, the original plan on that was we had budgeted in there $250,000 to do a overlay on it. And when they went and of course, we delayed and delayed and delayed that project. So then when they went and do the soil borings, it had been delayed too long and it turned into $1 million project.
Like an 8-inch overlay. Well, it's not an overlay, so we had...
Well, it was a reconstruct.
We ended up having to then move to a reconstruct project.
Yeah, so you can see the importance of trying to keep up with the maintenance versus...
letting it slide.
Yeah.
Mr. Chair, and I'm not sure about this, but that Felton Prairie property up there, as far as a wetland restoration trade-off of acreage, I'm not exactly sure, but it seems like some of that stuff would qualify, and I'm wondering maybe just going through the process, I think that's something we need to follow up on.
Sure.
Because there could be some acreage there that would qualify for wetland restoration, and I know it has to meet certain qualifications, but since we're playing around with that anyway and talking about it, we should probably rethink that real close before we liquidate that property, if we do.
All right. Thank you, Dave and Eric.
Yep, thank you very much. Got some nice bids, that was kind of nice.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. And you got your main bridge man here for support too, huh?
Yeah.
All right, Julie? Good morning.
Good morning. Well, actually, I have two agenda items today. Should we just start with the employee vacancy?
Yeah, we'll do with your correctional officer first.
Sure. So I have a full-time officer who will be going to the Moore Police Department, which leaves a vacancy on our shift. I'm requesting that we fill that immediately. This is a budgeted position, and there will be some cost savings. The employee had been with us for a couple of years.
Move to approve.
Second.
We have a motion and a second. Any further discussion? If not, all in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed, the same. Motion carried. Okay, now we're going to get into the inmate video visitation agreement.
Sure. This is really a transition item with the new jail coming very rapidly. We will be losing our public entrance for the jail, which also means we'll lose our public visitation. We've figured out some options, and our best option would be to run video visitation, where we would put video booths in our existing jail visitation area on the inmate side, and then put the video visitation for the public at the annex. That way, the public can go to the annex to visit inmates at the jail. That public entrance stays open. It's still somewhat of a secure area, and the staff over there do have the time to manage that. Video visitation is an approved form of visitation across the U.S. It's pretty much standard practice nowadays, and actually in our new facility, it'll all be video visitation. We have our current contractor, which is Reliance, who can provide this for us. There's some minimal costs involved, and they would be able to get this up and running for us by April 1st. We will need some lines run. I've talked to IT, had them come over. They know what we need. So there'll be some small expenses there. But it's really the only way we can provide visitation for our jail, and it is a requirement.
So, go ahead.
My only question is, why do we have to go with an outside agency? Why couldn't we just set up the computer programs within?
The equipment would be pretty expensive, and the wiring. This will actually, what will happen is video visitation runs just like our inmate phones, and it's through our inmate phone company.
Okay.
So things are videoed and recorded,
okay.
And our investigators do want that information, so it's pretty valuable for us to have it tied in with our existing system.
Yep. Is there going to be separation in the annex to allow that? So you're having visitors come in there?
They won't ever come into the actual annex. So there's actually two doors, it's like a regular jail at the annex, so they'll just come into the front area where there's two booths already, because we already do visitation for the annex there. So they won't actually walk all the way in. They'll stay in that little public area, and the officer will get the information from them, and it's all through an iPad, sign them up. And then they'll call the jail and say, okay, I have so-and-so, you can bring them to the visiting booth, and then they can do a normal visitation.
Okay.
Do you have any problem with people not liking the visual, I mean, going on video instead of the actual face-to-face?
We haven't had to do that yet here in Clay County, but all the counties we send inmates to, that's what they're accustomed to there, because that's what they have there. So it won't be a big surprise to our inmates.
Okay.
Although, did we make an exception for minors visiting parents?
Maybe in the new facility, but not
in the new facility, that's what I mean.
Yeah, there is some options we're looking at for that.
Okay.
Where we have built-in contact visitation as well as a regular booth like we currently have where there's a glass partition.
Right.
Yeah.
I just wanted to clarify that in the new facility for minors visiting parents, it's not video only.
Not necessarily.
Okay.
It'll depend on the situation and classifications.
Because I think that went into part of our planning for spaces, correct?
In some of the contact rooms, yes.
Right.
So Julie, you're asking for the approval then of this video visitation lease agreement?
Correct.
And that, but then also in your document to us, you said attach a draft of the resolution, policy, procedure, protocol, et cetera, that the board is being asked to adopt. Because we're instituting something different here, are we supposed to be seeing some sort of a policy and procedure?
No, I'm not asking for a policy sign off from you. I'm just asking you to sign the attached agreement.
Okay.
Because it's a contract agreement.
Okay, so do we have an existing protocol then for what you're going to be doing so that...
Well, I have an existing policy for visitation. And,
okay, you're going to follow that?
It'll be the same. The only thing that'll be different will be the times. We'll change the times and probably the duration of the visits. I've talked to the DOC what the requirements are. Since we're going from 5 booths down to 2, we'll have to do a little changing on the time frame.
I think maybe we can approve this, but Brian, maybe if we could do a little follow-up on if we're doing something different that might require a change in what's on record as our procedures, then we should be taking formal action on that at some point.
Sure. I think Julie is totally correct on it. They have this procedure possibly before. What you have is just a prototype here of a format, and they have the policies in place to cover this.
Okay, all right. Okay.
Move to approve.
Any motion? Is there a second?
Second.
Second. Any further discussion? All in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
All right, Julie.
All right, thank you.
Mm-hmm. All right, Brian. Approval of the 2017 Community Solar Garden Module Ownership Agreement.
Good morning, Mr. Chair and other commissioners. You have already approved going forward with this agreement, but at the time when Dennis was here, Dennis and Bill were here to present this to you, they had the old document, the 2016. They said there may be some changes on it. They just wanted to make sure the figures were correct in doing so, and which they did, and they sent it over and just thought it would be wise to bring it back for your final approval of the agreement. The purchasing cost is $410 per module. If you remember right, you were buying the entire panel of 72 modules, and you're buying the entire array, and it was $29,360. There's two different ways to pay, 12 equal installments of $420 per each panel or module, or $410 if we pay one lump sum. And I discussed this with Lori, and we're recommending that you go with the one lump sum. It's a little bit cheaper, and Just to reiterate, this project started out as an idea, and I will credit Commissioner Mojo and Commissioner Gross were on a committee, were to look at the solar gardens or the solar panels. And when we started the new correctional facility, we looked at putting solar panels on the roof of that building. And if you remember right, the moon roofs, or the sunlight roofs on the skylights, that's what they're called, skylights, thank you, prohibited that. But you wanted the idea of utilizing solar energy. And frankly, it kind of settled down, and I'll think as honest as I can. And Commissioner Mojo and Commissioner Gross really kind of pushed the idea that we should really stay green when we're putting up these new buildings. And we reached out to, or Moorhead Public Service reached out to us, I guess, and we met with them, and frankly, it kept pushing along, and here we have an agreement that you folks have signed off on and purchasing an entire array of solar panels that'll be put out at the at their solar gardens. And I just think it's a fantastic idea, one that you folks are really subscribing to keeping this new construction green as possible. So it's just back before you for validation of the revised agreement. So,
do we need to approve the payment schedule?
I would think that would be appropriate, yes.
Mm-hmm.
And I don't want to be the one to say anything. I guess I was going to turn it over. I plan to turn it over immediately to one of the commissioners here that wanted to speak something about it, because they were pretty excited about it. And I know you too, Commissioner Whalen, and yourself, Chair, Mr. Chair, were very excited about going green on this project as well. So it's part of our a real positive program that's going on here with this construction. So,
I guess my initial thought on this was, when we were first talking about this green, I was sort of thinking solar panels on the correctional facility itself, and I was sort of opposed to it, you know, because I didn't think that's a very good idea to do that. But after working with Moorhead and showing that we can buy these panels and have them out there by the wind turbines, you know, I just fully agree with what they're doing. And we look at the savings that we can have after about 10 years, we're going to start saving this money, so, for the county. So I just think it's a great situation, and I'd make a motion to approve this and the payment.
I'll second the motion.
Mm-hmm. Any further?
I also want to say I really appreciate it. I know a lot of work went into the meetings and working this out, and I think the tipping point really was when MCIT, the insurance piece of it, kind of came together. I think it's an opportunity for Clay County to partner with a great agency in town and maybe lead by example and save the save residents some money in the way of it. So.
Well, Mr. Chair, just one other thought, and you had this in your presentation that from Moorhead Public Service, but the saving, the green print, or carbon footprint of savings of more than 25,000 gallons of fuel would be saved with the solar panel. That's a lot in the carbon footprint of this country. If everybody would do something like that, I think it would be really a step in the right direction. Not that I'm saying we have a global warming. I don't want to get into that issue. But I just think it's fantastic. I want to compliment the board and Moorhead Public Service for willing to share the cost on the installation of this. They've been just a real willing partner. I think that needs to be noted as well. So,
mm-hmm. Very good. Any further discussion? All in favor of the motion signify by saying aye.
Aye. Aye.
Opposed, the same sign. Motion carried.
Thank you, Mr. Chair.
Thank you. Committee reports. Fred, can we start with you today?
Okay. Okay, on Tuesday, after our meeting, we had highway tracking, but I think we pretty much covered highway tracking pretty much either with the bid opening and with all the stuff that was covered today. But the one thing that I'm sure you've noticed, that there are lights on 11th Street and 15th Avenue now. I don't know if you drive north or not, but we got some lights up there now, and I think the future plan is to put them over in Highway 75 also, so that's probably going to happen sometimes in the future. I don't know, you know when that's supposed to happen? I didn't put my date down.
Well, yeah, I'm not positive on it. I think, you know, it's a Moorhead, and that's actually a Moorhead and MnDOT, that one in there. But I just want to add, too, that at our intergovernmental retreat, Bob Zimmerman, the engineer, mentioned that right now there gets to be some delays with those lights up there because they don't have the, they didn't have the technology in there yet that can determine.
Sensors.
Yeah, sensors that determine how many cars are in line. And he said they were supposed to be installed shortly. So the people that are using that, if they can just have a little patience, it's going to be resolved soon, so.
And the other comes, we discussed the Linden project and the Holly project, and Dave pretty much covered that already. That afternoon, we had Heartland Trail meeting, and a lot of discussion that in order to get funds for Heartland Trail, you have to make it available for snowmobiles. And I'm sure you can recall, our last 3-4 years, there hasn't been a lot of snowmobile going on because there just hasn't been the snow here to do it. You know, but we need to make it accessible to snowmobiles. And I'm trying to get a talk to, I think the DNR, where was the Eric, to see if you could check into why do we have to make it accessible to snowmobiles when we don't really can, we can't provide snowmobiles because there's no snow for it. And then they put asphalt trails in, and the first place that snow is going to melt on is on an asphalt trail. So I'm trying to get them to check into why we need to make it accessible. You know, probably could get a trail through there better if it wouldn't have to be accessible to snowmobiles. Not that I'm against snowmobile trails, but in order to get funds for it, we have to do that.
Yeah, I think with the DNR involved, they have to be multi-use trails to get.
That's right. That's right. And I'm trying to find out why, when you don't have snow for trails, you know, why do you have to make them accessible to snowmobiles? So that was a because I know at the site of the at the Buffalo Rivers park there, there's sort of a against snowmobiles in the park there, so they run into a problem there. Wednesday Historical Society, everything going good there. They've got some good donations. A lot of programs going on there, and I don't know if you get it in your emails or not, you know, about all the programs going on there. I would encourage people to attend some of those things. We had 3 new members that are, last month I said something about we need new members there, and we had 3 new people there looking to be members, so probably get a full staff of directors there real quick. The highway meeting on Thursday with the townships, again, that's pretty well been explained by Dave. The thing I took out of there was that none of the hot townships that were there or anybody really had any complaints about the services going on, you know, and I think it really went good, you know, I mean, it just, so it was, they're satisfied with the service they're getting, I think, and working with the townships and stuff like that, they're nice and good to work with, and it was just it was a good meeting with the townships, and I think they're satisfied with the service they're getting, and that went very good. MetroCog on Thursday also, they're looking at relocating, I think, the metro area transit out to West Acres. But I think that's, I don't know, they haven't run into some problems. They don't want to give them the space out there at West Acres or whatever. So run into problems there. There's a 17th Avenue corridor study going all the way across 17th Avenue and Fargo, making that pretty much a thoroughfare. So that's working. And then we talked about the bicycle plan. And then on Saturday, had a meeting with our legislators out at the CCRI on ARC, where they're looking, trying to get home care, more money for home care for people with disabilities or with disabilities. So I had that meeting, attended that meeting, and they're trying to just get some more money for people who need help at home and stuff, with the children and stuff. And those are the ones I had.
Commissioner Haney?
Thank you, Commissioner. Wednesday through Friday, I, myself, and three of you additional commissioners attended the AMC Legislative Conference in St. Paul. Wednesday night, we had the Rural Minnesota Counties Organization. We were briefed by senior leadership from both houses and both parties, and very interesting topics there, what's working its way through the legislative process this year. And then on Thursday, late morning, I attended the Health and Human Services Committee meeting for the first time and heard the issues there. That was very interesting. And then on Friday, we had the breakfast and then the legislative update that all of us attended in the main ballroom, and we heard additional information from senior leadership in both the House and Senate and from both parties. And that was it.
All right. Very good. Commissioner Ojo.
Thank you. Last week, I also attended the AMC legislative update. I am on the Environment and Natural Resources Committee. We heard updates from the current bills that are on the floor for discussion of preference. Clearly, the buffer strip continues to be a big update. So we had updates from the DNR, including Commissioner Landwehr, who came to our session to talk. One thing that was different for me this year that I observed was we received updates from all the policy analysts from the different committees, and I thought that was a very valuable time. Oftentimes you all give great updates, but clearly it's not at a legal or the policy analyst level, so I appreciated hearing that. I also did attend the update brunch the next day from the Senate and House majority and minority leaders. Well, one other thing that I did have a pretty good conversation with a commissioner from Pennington that is building their jail and cautioned us about the legal wait time for getting permits approved at the state level. They lost all fall to construction because of that, so they're hoping to get in. Hopefully that's not the case for us. And also was interesting, there are several bills being discussed that could potentially affect Clay County in the form of grants. There's a grant dollar set aside that may be available for mental health treatment options in correctional facilities, of which Frank and I are on that committee to discuss programming, and also possible grant funding for out-of-home placement dollars. So we'll see. Hopefully the legislative leaders agree to passing a tax and bonding bill that would benefit a lot of us, so we wait to see. That concludes my report.
Thank you. Commissioner Wayland.
I also was at the AMC conference and attended the public safety policy meetings, and I also attended an open meeting law and data practice session that was pretty informative. I think Commissioner Haney already mentioned, but the Minnesota Rural Counties meeting on Wednesday night, a lot of information from the legislature, and they all seem to understand that the bonding bill is needed this year, so hopefully that'll come to pass. And there was a lot of discussion on the wetland mitigation credits issue, too. It was a lot of discussion, a lot of concern over that, and mainly that a lot of road projects will be shut down around the state if there isn't some money funding or money coming to fund that project. So that was it for me.
I have one addition there. Not really a meeting I attended, but you know, we've been working on our comprehensive plan. We've been talking about it. You know, that and the bill that we got from MetroCOC was a little bit high, and I got some information. I know West Fargo, I don't know if they went on their own and did their own comp plan or hired someone to do their comp plan. I wonder if we should be looking at, I don't know, working with or talking to West Fargo and seeing if there's a better way to do our comp plan, you know, it's a cheaper way to do it. Well, not only cheaper, but a good way to do it. Sometimes cheaper is not better, but we should probably check it in before get going again on a comp plan. I think we should be talking to some other people. other than MetroCog, I'll get it done.
Mm-hmm. Okay, very good. All right, I had last week on Tuesday, we did have the Highway Tracking Committee, and I guess there's no need to expand on that anymore. That same day in the afternoon, I was invited to a meeting by First Ward City Council member from Moorhead, Sarah Watson Curry, to meet with some of our solid waste staff and along with a member of the Fargo City Commission to further discuss the plastic bags issue that was presented to our solid waste a while back in terms of the goal is to try to reduce the amount of plastic bags being used. And I think you're going to, I think at our solid waste advisory committee meeting on this Thursday, there's going to be some additional dialogue and report on that. And at which some point in time, there will probably be some conversation brought before this board.
Kevin?
Yeah.
At our recycling drop-offs throughout the county, do mm-hmm. we have a plastic bag drop-off?
I
know at some of the bigger box stores they do. And
yeah, and I know they have them in the grocery stores have them. And I do believe that not all of our recycling locations have enough bins for sorting them, but I do believe that the major ones do have locations for plastic bags as well. The whole idea is that they're bad for the landfill, they're bad for Prairie Lakes, they're just not good anywhere, so.
Right.
That discussion of plastic bags was also brought up at the MetroCog, you know, and their question, I think, was, is it a MetroCog issue?
Yeah, and I would think it would not be a MetroCog issue myself, but anyway, so and it, Commissioner Mojo brought up the fact that in our policy committee meetings, we were able to get a report from the other committees, and I thought that was fantastic. That was something that I hadn't seen them do. As if they did, it was just maybe a 1 minute deal before, or we had a shared. I know transportation and health and environment shared a couple of committee meetings in the past, but this was really good. And so I just got a couple of things, questions out of it. And Brian, maybe you can take note on some of these things too. I know that there is a proposed increase to drug court funding. And it's in the process right now, and it's for existing drug courts. Cool. So I would request that we maybe have Judge Lawson's what's his
Don
name?
Kautzman.
Huh?
Don Kautzman.
Yeah, Don. Maybe he can research that, or maybe
sure.
he's aware of it. But I think we should follow up on that. And then. In your public safety area, there was a, we were told that there's a $1 million available with a 50% match for court security, but it must be applied for by March 30th. I don't know if we have any issues there in court security that we would be thinking of, but there's some information there. Then in the general government, the county program aid in that process, and I think we even heard from some of the local legislatures, both at the MRC meeting and then at the legislative leadership talks, that our county program aid, we're asking for an additional $40 million into that, and along with that, there's a change in that formula. And you know, as long as we're following what that formula change would be and how it, I think they were trying to make it so that it would benefit every county.
Right.
I think right now the current formula is one county that it would not benefit based on the formula, but it's something that we should follow to make sure that formula works for Clay County. And then there is another piece regarding the data practices.
Yeah.
And that was one that was really quite interesting. Right now, we have a retention area that, when we talked about this, I think in our board meeting here not too long ago, and we even updated our policy.
You just approved, yeah, Colin.
And now there's some discussion that they want this to go to a three-year retention on all emails. And that you know, and that includes emails that don't pertain to any policy or anything. And it would, and they're saying it would be a huge cost for storage and a huge cost in attorney's fees that would then have to review them all for possible redaction for private information.
Right.
So this is another something that could be coming along that, and obviously you want to be open to the public,
mm-hmm.
But there becomes a point when there's some things that are just.
Well, and the cost for staff time for retrieval, there's a reimbursement for paper, but there's not a reimbursement for what the burden would be on staff time.
Right. So it's something that I think we need to monitor that and talk with our local legislatures on as that comes on. So, okay, so that was, I guess that ends, that concludes mine. So Brian, you had a busy week last week yourself.
Let me just hand this out first. And Mr. Chair, this was your suggestion on maybe delaying March 7th meeting a little bit.
Oh, yes. Thank you for
getting back here to my mic.
I did that because I certainly want to go to that.
Yeah, the information got cut off a little bit. They printed this in a hurry this morning, but you still get the message that on March 7th, that's a board meeting, and you've done this before. You've delayed the start of your meeting, and your chair requested that we consider this for March 7th to allow the opportunity for new commissioners to attend this Blue Ribbon Commission on Addiction. It's a 7:30 to 9 o'clock meeting. We do happen to have a bid opening at 9:15 that day, and we just looked at the schedule this morning, and if we started at 9:15 or 9:20, that would be, so allow you folks to get back from that. I think it would work fine. So
When I saw this out there, and I know Commissioner Mojo and I have been on the Clay County Joint Powers Collaborative as well as Brian, and this has been a really important topic, and I think it was part of what we even did at our intergovernmental retreat, and it really fits in, and I just think it would be I certainly really want to attend this, and I would hope that if other commissioners want to, that we could change the time on this and then have Colleen get us registered. It's being put on by the Chamber Eggs and Issues on March 7th, so.
I agree. I think it'd be something that's very valuable to be a part of. The only thing is if we move that back, I think we have a jail behavioral health meeting scheduled tentatively for right after board, so we may need to shift that as well.
Yeah, we can shift that a little bit too, so. And we can keep Mr. Chair, I'm sorry. Mm-hmm. We can keep a lighter load too for the agenda. We can do that. We can manage that a little bit.
Okay. All right. So we would that would require a motion to change our meeting time.
I'll make the motion to push back the March 7th meeting time. Do we need to clarify what time that was?
Yeah, why don't you put 9:15?
To 9:15.
9:15.
Mm-hmm. Perfect. Thank
okay.
You.
Second.
We have a motion and a second. All in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed, the same. Motion carried. And then can you all let Colleen know this morning if you plan on attending that? Because then we'll ask her to enroll us in that. I think we were supposed to do that. So I know you can. I'm going to. So. Okay. Okay. Brian, do you have other?
Yeah, I do have a couple other things.
All right. A couple other. You're sounding like VJ again.
Oh, sorry. Well, no, that's not bad.
That's too
thank you, Mr. Chair. Yeah, I know you mentioned that to me, and I knew it was important to you, so we wanted to get things put in line for that. Also, just a reminder that Thursday, that's this Thursday, is the Rural Cities meeting out at the Holly City Hall. So just wanted to remind you that it's on the back of the schedule. And also, the approval of bills. I've had a little bit of discussion with a couple commissioners from at various times on the approval of bills that you do every Tuesday morning, and some would like a little better review or a little time to review those bills on occasion. And I'm working with Mike and Lori to see if we can send you electronic document of those on Monday afternoons or something so that you can breeze through them so you can approve them Tuesday morning. I think that's a real positive thing to do. So we'll continue. There's some issues we have to work out, and you may not get them all because of some social services bills that people get locked into getting those right away. But Lori's out this week, and I was out last week. So we'll talk through that a little bit more. And we think that can work out good for everybody. We had a, and this is probably mentioned last week, so I'm gonna just skim over these. We had a Correctional Center Behavioral Health Committee meeting. You guys probably reported on that last week. And you made reference to it this morning in regards to the funding and things, and I think we've got some real good information that's coming forward on that. Even just the 211 service, the suicide prevention line, they're expanding that now to basically cover the county jails, which is going to be helpful for our staff and different things. So, Commissioner Mojo asked if that was on our website, and I checked with Mark. He assured me that it was. So then we went to the website, and it wasn't coming up very easy. So he said he's going to make that more convenient.
That's the 211, right?
I believe it is a 211.
But then isn't there a mobile mental health service? That's mobile mental health crisis unit. That's the one we were talking about.
Yeah, I thought that was, I thought that was the same. Yeah, I thought it was the same call center.
Okay.
There's one that was in the news, and it was in the news both when I was down in St. Paul and in the news here, that they were calling some of these lines and there was no answer.
Not getting an answer, yeah.
So what's the deal with that?
Yeah. Well, that's something to follow up on because there's some pretty substantial state dollars that are coming into the counties for that purpose, and they're coming through our social services department. So we learned that at our meeting, which was very helpful. I had a meeting with Shelley Jeffers, court administrator, in regards to the last time I did give you the expenditures and revenues for 2016. I did send you out an explanation on that, but just wanted to let you know that I did meet with her and we went through that completely. I won't go into the details of that because I forwarded that to you. Unless you have any questions about it, we can certainly talk about that. I attended Veterans Court, that first one, first graduation that they had here. Week and a half, I'm sure you reported on that last week when I wasn't here. We had an out-of-home placement meeting, and I think that was the week before. So that was probably reported on last Tuesday. Met with Kirk and the city administrator and Steve Moore and Kirk Rosenberg to talk about the different aspects of what is going on with the solid waste and the new design and the funding of it and all of those things, and it went really well. I did attend Larry Crone's retirement down in Otter Tail County. I'm not sure if you're aware, but you know he was the administrator down there, been with the county just shy of 40 years. 39 and a half or something, about 30 years of it as their coordinator, administrator, and so I did attend that. Last week, of course, I would have liked to attend, and I was signed up for that legislative update, but I spent all week long basically on the one-on-one groups, and they want us to be, they really, really stress the confidentiality of what we're doing with these four proposals that want to design and build the diversion project around Fargo. But just to give you a couple little highlights, they had over 1,100 inquiries from these different four groups on issues. And this was an opportunity to spend an entire day with each of the groups independently. A lot of legal questions, a lot of financial questions, a lot of risk questions, engineering, accountability, timing, redesigning, other things. And you know, if you remember right, this is a big, big, big expensive project and a lot of technicalities in it. They have a lot of concerns, we have a lot of concerns. And like I said, if you have over 1,100 inquiries back and forth, it was a lot of good dialogue. They had up to 15 people, 10 to 15 people from each of their teams. So they're running at a pretty high level on this. So And there's more to come. There's more one-on-ones later on. But it's quite a commitment from, well, I'll say from our staff, not necessarily us, Clay County, but Fargo and Cass County and Clay County and things to sit through these things. And but I feel it's very, very important as well. So that's where I was. And then we had a meeting Friday morning on the diversion executive director. We've really advanced in regards to a procedure and a process for that, and you'll hear about that extensively. I've got an email just received this morning. I'll forward that on to Grant and Kevin as well, or Commissioner Wayland and Campbell's in regards to it, because they'll be listening to that on Thursday at the board meeting as well on a process for moving forward on that. So we met on that last Friday morning as well. And then we had the administrative advisory last Thursday morning to talk over a lot of these things as well. April 4th. Now, we had talked to you about April 4th, keeping that available for a kind of a retreat with the department heads. That would be after board meeting on April 4th. That's a Tuesday. And our intentions are then to meet down at the highway department. We had been meeting at Usher's, and we're going to talk about succession planning within Clay County. And we're really not looking for resolution or plans on that. We're going to have a presenter, Heather from AMC. She took over Tony Smith's, and she is going to be the one that's presenting. Darren has been working with her on that, and Darren and I called her on Friday. This was prearranged phone call, and we think we have things pretty well set up. So the intent is to be out at the highway department. We'll have lunch brought in, and we'll meet from about 10 to 2:30 that day to talk about generalities of succession planning in each of the departments. And
what date is that again?
That's April 4th, Tuesday.
Okay.
And it'll run to about, so after board meeting, we'll head down there then and run to about 2:30, 3 o'clock, somewhere in that area. Mr. Chair, that concludes my report.
All right, thank you. Anything else today? All right, we will be adjourned.